Welcome to the Real Chili Podcast.
And the Golden Eagles of Marquette University in Milwaukee are bound for the Final Four for only the third time ever.
5 seconds left. Marquette down by one, trying to avoid the upset. Blue the drive, the left hand. It's good! 1 second!
I want to win every day as basketball players, as students, and I want to win every day, most importantly, as people.
Welcome to the good life.
We've been talking about free throws all night. We're tied.
Yeah, this game deserves overtime. If you're a fan, if you're us watching, I wouldn't mind seeing five more minutes. Get some popcorn in here.
Like we always do at this time, I go for mine, I get to shine. Now throw your hands up in the sky.
We are seeing a superstar.
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. Mike, let that play a little bit longer for the people. Don't turn it down. Oh, my God. It's Monday. Welcome to this solo endeavor of the Real Chili Podcast. My God, is the sky bluer? Is it possible? Does the coffee taste a little better on this Monday? Is everything just good in your world? I know the world is falling down upon us, but my God, for one glorious moment this past Friday night, that's right. Welcome to the good life, baby. How's it going, everybody? I'm Brian Henry. Welcome to the Real Chili Podcast. You know what? One reaction pod just wasn't enough following a game like Marquette just had against Wisconsin. I know none of you were under a rock. I won't even insult you with making that comment. 67-65, the Marquette Golden Eagles pull off arguably their biggest win in nearly four seasons as a program. You have to go back to January 24th of 2017, which if you had a pulse following this program at that time, everybody knows that they don't have to toss it out, upsetting Villanova, who was then number one in the country. That game against Villanova was completely stunning because that Nova team was an absolute buzzsaw. While beating Wisconsin wasn't as stunning as that game, I think considering what this team did last Tuesday against Oklahoma State, where they turned the ball over a ridiculous 24 times, losing 70-62 on their home floor. And I'm not going to say it's the lowest this fan base has been, because that would be far too hyperbolic. But I saw everybody on Twitter. I saw the various message boards. I saw the texts from friends and family. It's as down as people's been in a while, especially this early in the season. It was the, here we go again. This is what it is. This is what we are. And hey, we might be back there not too long. I'm not, God knows I'm not hoping for it. And certainly after Friday, I'm more optimistic of where things could go. But it was fair. The critique was reasonable. They looked like garbage on their home floor against a team who threw a 2-3 zone at them and they couldn't solve it. Well, the beauty of basketball and sport in general was on full display for all of us this past Friday night. It was like one of those absurd Friday Night Lights episodes from back in the day. Remember that, the old show on NBC? You know, the team looks like trash last week, and oh my God, after some hard work and a major pep talk from the coach, everything turns around. And that's what happened. This team went from being a pumpkin on Tuesday to Cinderella all dolled up for the ball on Friday. Marquette welcomes, arguably right now, and I always laugh at this because I think it varies for those of us who are born and raised in Wisconsin, and those of us who aren't, I fall in the aren't category. Marquette's current biggest rival, the Wisconsin Badgers. There's no other way to put it. I'd love to say that somebody in the Big East had reached that status, but after the conference blew up and you don't have Louisville, Cincinnati, Notre Dame, that group that kind of carried over from CUSA years ago, there isn't a real natural heated rival. God knows we'd love it to be DePaul, but yikes, that'll never happen. But whether you believe it or not, and the majority of you obviously do, Wisconsin's the biggest game on the schedule from a rivalry standpoint. I'm not going so far either to say it's the most important game, because it's not. Let's be real. You lose that game, stinks. Not the end of the world. Certainly doesn't. Marquette's lost to Wisconsin before. Doesn't crush a season. It's not a late March loss to Villanova on the road to Seton Hall when you're in a dogfight trying for a tournament spot. It's important. It's important to the people for both schools. It's important to the locals. Everyone knows the story, right? We're a school with no football team. This is it. This is the big one. And you went and beat your biggest rival right now on a huge stage. If you listen to our podcast on Friday night, I mean, we were all over the place. That game was as outrageous a finish as we've had of a Marquette game that went in our favor in quite some time. But we also got to witness, and I don't use it lightly. It's very easy, of course, to go over the top when someone delivers a great performance. Don't get it twisted. That was a coming out party for Justin Lewis. He looked good the previous couple games. Heck, we came on and said it was him and Jamal were the two best players against Oklahoma State. That was a freshman that came in and on both ends of the court carried you for a basketball game at home against the top five opponent. Carried you. No other way to put it. I think a very fair question that everybody has asked coming into the season was, who's taking crunch time shots for this team? God, we all know Kobe wants to do it, thinks he can do it. You know, and I can live with a little irrational confidence here and there. I'm not sure we all believe he should be doing it. They get into a tight game Friday night. They need big buckets, a minute left, down by two after Wisconsin gets a go-ahead layup. What do? Come down on the other end and run a pin play for Justin Lewis to get the ball on that left side block. Pardon me, on the right side block. And what's he do? Gets a bucket, dribbles middle, spins back left, gets a layup. His 18 points and 8 rebounds was an announcement of a star. It's going to be hard going forward. It'd be silly not to acknowledge it. You put a game like that on tape against that level of competition, you're going to draw a different type of defense. You know, I'll be fascinated to see what Wisconsin-Green Bay does this week when Marquette gets back on the court. He's not going to be able to sneak up on many, especially when Big East play goes around, right? These leagues and these coaches, as we've seen many times, they know Wojo inside and out. So we'll see if Justin's able to overcome that. Here's why I think he can. We just went through the Marcus Howard experience, right? You had to run every different play in the world, set screens, run Marcus off him like he was Steph Curry to try to get him a look. Obviously, because he was a small guy, right? He's 5'10", 5'11". Justin Lewis has size, length, and strength. And you saw on the majority of his buckets, when he wasn't scoring off offensive rebounds, which, God, is that awesome to see, he was smart and skilled enough to catch the ball in one-on-one situations, make quick decisions, and attack. We haven't had a big with that level of intuitiveness in some time. All due respect to Henry Ellenson and Luke Fisher and Theo John for stretches. We all know, we love Theo, and I'm going to get to Theo in a second because I still think it's underrated the importance that he played, and there's a big stat that backs that up with the way that game played out. But you can get Justin Lewis in one-on-one matchups and win against elite talent. And that's what you saw. Look, I don't think it's fair to expect him to give you 18 and 8 against the four times you're going to play Villanova and Creighton this year. That would just be silly. They need more from Dawson Garcia offensively. We know that. He knows that. I think he'll get there. I don't know if it'll be full form this year, like everybody's hoping and dreaming for, but he's going to get there. The kid's got talent. But Justin Lewis's game, for anybody that's watched the first four games of the season, and especially from Friday night, smart and skilled to play one-on-one on that block. He can get to his right hand, to his left hand, half hook in the middle, spin and pin. He threw up and unders. He did work Friday night. Absolute work. And the good vibes that everyone's feeling in Marquette basketball fan land, you better thank that young man. They better be rolling into the spirit shop and rolling out number two jerseys after that performance, because I can think of a whole bunch of people that would buy them. Unbelievable. Under a minute left, down two, he's the guy they're going to. And hey, you know, you ask those guys, they might sit there and tell you, hey, that's what the defense gave us. We went to it. Well, shame on Wisconsin at that point of the game if they hadn't figured it out that that was the guy probably not to get the ball, because he was the one that wanted it. And he was confident he could score. I don't know who has to sit more, but he's got to be on the court 30 minutes a game. I think we've reached that point. I believe on Friday it was about somewhere between 26 and 27 minutes for Justin Lewis. I think that number is going to go up. I think it'd be crazy to think otherwise. Now, it's a little less Dawson. It's a little less Theo at different moments. Maybe you play a little bigger, a few fewer minutes for take your pick. One of the guards you want to sit. I'm not sure who, but I'll take another 3 minutes of Justin Lewis on the court. I mentioned Theo a second ago, and I will get to the positives of him in just a moment, but I want to go to a minute as I continue on Justin. And I'm going to tie in Dawson Garcia to this. 8:51 mark, Theo picks up his fourth foul. Marquette's up by a bucket, I believe, at that moment. He goes to the bench just under 9 minutes left. You're now going to play against, obviously, the behemoths that Wisconsin's rolling out around the basket with two young pups in the biggest game they've played of their basketball careers to date, right, for both Garcia and Lewis. They stepped up defensively. The infusion of both of them on the defensive side of the court, I mean, shoot, I'll even toss in DJ Carton. I know he's not a freshman, but they have the three of them, and especially the two bigs, they've made this a better defensive team, right? Lewis has got a 7-foot wingspan. I don't have DJ's in front of me. I don't have Dawson's in front of me, but they're not lacking for it either. They held that Wisconsin team to 37.5% shooting on the night. Now, it has to be acknowledged, Badgers missed a lot of good open looks from three. You would be silly to come away with this going, yeah, Wisconsin shoots a little better from deep. That game probably goes the other way, right? 7 for 24, just under 30%. They knocked down 2-3 more. Obviously, it's a very different game. But they did the best they could, forced them into perimeter shots. They didn't knock down as many tonight. God knows Wisconsin wants to get into the paint as much as anybody and let those bigs do work down there. They did a good job forcing them to kick. Did knock down open looks. I think you got to do a better job defending the perimeter, especially in this Big East you're about to go into, because you will get your ass blown out of the gym by teams that'll shoot it and make you pay for it. But we'll learn about that more as they go forward. You would assume a young group like this is only going to get better. So props to those two, the two young bigs, doing a great job defensively. Props to DJ. But I'll finally circle back to Theo here, and as I kind of alluded to there, hey, someone's got to sit a little bit more to get more time for Justin Lewis. Let it be known, if you didn't see it, I think everyone noticed it out there. Best plus minus for anyone on Marquette's team from Friday night? Any guesses? It was Theo John. 24 minutes of action, he was a plus 11. They defended, they rebounded, and he helped move the ball much more effectively. Now, I think it's painfully clear against zone defenses, especially now with what you're getting from Justin Lewis, I think Theo might see the court less for teams that want to zone at Marquette, especially coming off that Oklahoma State game. But if they're going to stay man and give him opportunities to high ball screen and roll, he's going to play about that 25 minutes that we talked about. And we all know that probably would have been up closer to 27 had he not gotten in foul trouble. But look, hey, Theo rolls out of bed with four fouls, right? So that's probably going to be him most every night. It's worth spinning back and looking at the final minute of the game. I know I've hit a couple stretches of it, but that was one area where Friday night we probably could have gone deeper into it on the reaction podcast, but you know, everybody was just spitballing. We were so damn excited. Aleem Ford gives Wisconsin a 61-60 lead after a three-pointer with 109 remaining. And that's where we've already touched on, right? They come down, they get the ball to Justin Lewis. Wow, they went to him in that situation. Immediately gets a bucket. Badgers come right flying back down the other way. They find Nate Reavers for a layup. DJ Carton, thank you for showing up. Don't win this game without him on the offensive end. DJ Carton gives you 12 points on 4 for 13 shooting, but he was huge, huge in the second half. He comes right down on the other end and gets a transition layup. Had to have it. Gives Marquette a 64-63 lead with 19 seconds left. Everyone and their brother is watching that game, praying for a stop. And props to Demetri Trice. That was a hell of a shot. That was a hell of a shot that he hit to put Wisconsin up by one. They did exact, but then they come off of that and they do exactly what you hope for in those situations. Marquette had a timeout left. I'm glad Wojo didn't use it. Get the ball and go, force them to match up and stop you. DJ Carton takes off. Everybody lived on social media and saw the discrepancy in the clocks. I'm not going to sit and break that down, but the clock was right in the building. That's all anybody needs to know. Clock on TV, for those that aren't aware, Fox is doing remote broadcasts on these. The announcers aren't in the arena. They got techs that aren't there. They're beating Steve Lavin sitting in Los Angeles trying to do these games. Bad look on the production side for the television crew. Clocks weren't synced up. Made the game look off like it should have ended, right? Regardless, I gave love to Demetri Trice a moment ago for the shot that he hit. He, after making that shot, committed, and it's epidemic in college basketball. I think he committed, obviously, the boneheaded play of the game. No other way to spin it. To attempt to take a charge in that scenario, I understand what he was trying to do. I know why everyone attempts it in college basketball, because God knows referees can't wait to shift their weight, throw their arm out the other direction, and offense! They can't wait to call the offensive foul. He thought he could get it in a big moment. Instead, it just turned into a hip check. Looked like he was playing hockey. I mean, God bless you. Thanks for doing it. Because I'm not sure DJ gets a great look off the rate he was going. It was going to be a falling to his left potential game winner. He gets bailed out because he gets hip checked by Demetri Trice. Now you're going to the foul line. And oh my God, was that first one big. Whew. The way it hit the back of the rim too, hit the front and went down. I know everybody out there was holding their breath. And then the play of plays, the plays that will, I don't think it's too much to be said. This will live in Marquette lore for decades. This tipping by Justin Lewis. That's not being hyperbolic. It 100% will. It'll go right up there with Doc Rivers, shot inside half court to beat Notre Dame. God, take your pick of the, for those that follow like MU Overload on Twitter, they were posting all the great buzzer beaters and program history. This will be right at the top there with all of them. You have the outside position on a free throw. A 7-footer standing next to you in Micah Potter, who, thank you for not stepping in and boxing out Justin Lewis. Justin Lewis has the wherewithal to get into the key quick, get off the floor, and tip the damn thing like a volleyball. And it freaking goes down. You can't script it any better. Team dog piles on the court. Shouts to Cam Murata. Saw you about to dive onto that pile. And then you held yourself up. You were in player mode just for a second. Very entertaining. Way to go, Cam. It's going to be a long time before you see a better ending to a Marquette basketball game, considering where the fan base was mentally going into that game, considering who the opponent was, considering they were ranked in the top five of the country. Look, I'm with everybody else. You know, early season rankings, they all come with a grain of salt, right? Is Wisconsin a top five team? Probably not. They're pretty darn good, though. They're going to be ranked pretty much all season. you know, Big Ten's going to be an absolute war. You know, they'll lose a few games. That's going to be a good basketball team. They didn't play great against us, but a big reason for that was our ability to force them to not play great. We defended well. We hit shots where we needed to. You know, you gave yourself a chance to upset a good team. That's the great thing about that. I mean, look, as much as we, and everybody out there loves college football for the most part, I think in our fan base, regardless of what team you follow, or even if you're just a casual fan like myself, look, Akron's not going to challenge Alabama, right? I mean, you got about a 1 in 1,000 chance that that's going to happen. You know, not, and that's not to imply we're Akron to Alabama in this situation, but teams upset teams in basketball regularly, right? Teams that aren't as necessarily as talented. You can outplay somebody for 40 minutes. It's only 5 guys you can put on the court. Can't use the other, you know, 10 guys in scholarship that you have. And this Marquette team went out and did it. Biggest thing going forward from this, which will be interesting, this Marquette team only shot about 14 threes in this game, which made sense. They were getting buckets in the paint. They were posting with Garcia. They were posting with John. God knows they were posting with Lewis. It'll be interesting to see teams aggressively double. This is now back-to-back games. We haven't really hurt somebody from the perimeter. Didn't really hurt Oklahoma State from the perimeter, and didn't really hurt this Wisconsin team from deep. I think you're going to start to see opponents really aggressively dig down on Marquette's bigs as they catch down there and force DJ Carton, Jamal Cain, Kobe McEwen, Greg Elliott. Shouts to Greg for the 15 minutes he gave. How efficient was he? Samir Torrance. Those guys are going to have to knock down shots, plain and simple, going forward. We're going to celebrate this victory, no doubt, and everybody has been for the last 3-4 days whenever you're listening to this. But that going forward is going to be a big thing with this team that we all need to follow, because you got to shoot it better, especially going into the Big East Conference. You have to shoot it better, not a choice. Well, that does it for this abbreviated version of Real Chili to Go. I just had a few more thoughts to get out there. The rest of the guys, unfortunately, had real-life stuff to take care of tonight, and why not? Had a couple extra minutes, have some fun, and get on here and wax poetic for a little bit. We'll be back on after the UW-Green Bay game reacting. We'll be fascinated to see how the team shoots it and how you bounce back. Can't have a letdown, right? This is what it's ultimately going to come down to for this roster, right? There is a spark there. There is talent. I think we all see it. There are reasons to be optimistic. They cannot just show up and cruise past people. That's not that kind of talent. And if you don't show up against Wisconsin Green Bay, you'll end up in a dogfight and sweating it out like we've seen, you know, other teams do against inferior competition. Come ready to play on Tuesday, and it'll be fun to see it as the march continues to Big East play. Thanks to everyone for listening. For Mike, Pete Worth, Pete Mohan, and Eric Pond, I'm Brian Henry. This is the Real Chili Podcast. We'll catch you next time.
My teammate DJ, I was banging on him to hit the first two, and I didn't even look. The second shot, I didn't even look up because I thought I wanted him to send us home. So then it went off, and I just crashed in, tipped it in.
Steve, that final play, just what moxie does it take for a young guy like that to know, hey, whatever it takes, I got to get position and put that thing up toward the rim?
Well, it was an incredible play. First of all, to have the mindset of playing through the horn, you know, even though there's 0.9 seconds on the clock, to anticipate a miss. Nobody was hoping that DJ missed, obviously, but to have the foresight to be ready to try to make a play if he did miss is incredible for any player, but especially a freshman.